thanks to the organizers for the opportunity to present and more to learn about machine learning, because I'm from the newcomer to this field, and I'm working as a part of that CP group, so many of the techniques that I have here, I can find a way to use them in experience. So what I talk today is about learning skill environments, particularly if you have the ability to make these measurements in a projective way. And we have been using talks today about Ancilla assisted, how Ancilla could assist a sensor network, or such as for showing how an Ancilla assisted, you have a quantum system, or maybe a RMRK, something. So, I'll try to show some theory and also experimental data, which is in a sense trying to confirm that. And as you can see on this slide, and so what we work with is with nitrogen vacancy sensors in Bangalore. So maybe I'll plan. So what I talk, first I try to reduce the sensor, the quantum sensor, which is trying to interact with the environment. And this is a common thing we always have in quantum system, like you are always interacting with the surrounding environment, and maybe it fits well into this agent environment paradigm in reinforcement learning. And then let's see if we can reinterpret our results in this language of machine learning. Then I talk about this measurement-based control environment, for example, the example that Elias was mentioning earlier. Today's talk in the morning, that this Nobel Prize work of Farouk, where like they're having these Rydberg atoms which are passing through the cavity, they interact with the cavity, and then you are measuring the Rydberg atoms. So in a way that by measuring the Rydberg atoms, you are collapsing the cavity into some mode state, or like you are learning something about the cavity through it. So in that sense, I will show some things around those lines. I talk about what we can do. So maybe one can ignore the details if you're not interested, but just to introduce for you more. So nitrogen vacancy center is like in the diamond lattice, it's a defect. You can see that one of the carbon atoms is taken over by nitrogen, and then there's adjacent vacancies. And this has a spin triplet ground state. So it means that very sensitive to magnetic fields. Kind of a lattice environment, it also tends to electric fields. The nice thing is, like, if you go to load of filter, there are well-resolved optical transitions, and then you can read out a given spin state you want projectively, and this is where you can use the projective filter. And the reason why I want to show the slide is because there are a lot of theories here, and these systems are much more easier to use in any setting. It doesn't cost much. As you can see, these are all room temperature. You can calculate them at room temperature also to get the effects. It just needs very less experimental, I'd say, cost. And this is what it's known for. Like here is like this structure, it's a diamond substrate, and whatever you put on top, your skin is sensitive to the fields created by these objects, and then you are able to learn something about them. So what could achieve is something like a nanoscale MRI, and these are extremely sensitive, so it's your function, like a picotesla fields, picotesla forces. So what becomes important more is like, because it's so sensitive to the fields, you can also be sensitive to this quantum noise. And that becomes interesting in certain limits. Or like one can use certain spins in the lattice to actually think of a register, and then you think of doing some simple quantum information protocols. Or like what a Delft book has shown is this Berlin for the violation. One can also use these centers for such experiments. And today's goal is like environment. I have like a really complex environment which is surrounding my quantum sensor, and it is I have no knowledge about this, except that maybe I know what speed. tablet screen or if that is some electronic screen sensor. And there could be a variety of interaction between the sensor screen and the surrounding screens, and also the screens themselves, the glass which can themselves be interacting. So I just want to show, like, is there some knowledge that I can gain if I have only the ability to control or read out the sensor screen. In a sense, like, we can also control the environment, but today I just concentrate on it. And whenever it comes about some interaction between quantum system and the environment, so the natural place where it's called is the open quantum system. And this is a nice book from Tejas Mukherjee itself, where you can get everything about open quantum systems and control. And then if you look at into this agent environment paradigm in reinforcement learning, what Karan was talking yesterday in more detail. So what you can do as an agent is that you try to get some information, so the agent could have some sensors through which he is learning about something about the environment, and then he's doing some actions on top of the environment, and in doing so, sometimes he's getting some rewards or so on. So for a quantum agent, the best reward that you can give is that you could make it remain quantum. That is, you can make it have longer coherence time, or if the agent itself is not a single probe, but it's like a multi-probe system, then maybe the environment is assisting to also generate some entangling of the system. And one of the serious things in quantum interactions is like there's a measurement back action. And how does it help is like in the way that agent is trying to infer something about the environment, he's also doing a kind of action at the same time on the environment. So it's like action and perception. So these are happening simultaneously because of the measurement package. So this is my model here. I have my ancilla, which is my the agent, and this is the environment. And they're interacting with some complicated Hamiltonian. And what I'm doing is like I'm measuring my ancilla once in a while, and then something is happening also the environment that it is being projected onto some different space. So just to start with, I need to know some knowledge about the environment. So like what I know is because these are spins, they have different magnetic components, and there's a distribution with what probability a certain state with a certain magnetic moment can count. That's what I know, a priori, let's say. And when I give an environment like this, the first thing that I do is just do a FID, which is a field induction decay. So I set a Ramp's experiment. So I start with a Hadamard gate, I create a superposition, I let it evolve for a time, and I get it. And from this, what I get is how the coherence of the state, initial state, decays, and from there I set what is negative. So, in getting to this experiment, each data point that I get here is averaged over thousands of times to get a good data point with less deviation. So, what you want to ask is like, instead of averaging over many times, if I take one measurement string, for example, this is like a real jump data that you see in experiment. So the bright spots correspond to, let's say, zeros, and blue spots correspond to one. So in a given experiment run, you're seeing like some zeros, like in 250, maybe the hundreds of zeros, and remaining 150 ones. And so this could look like the probability of how close is the state to the initial state. But then you see that that is changing every time. So this could like you feel that maybe the environment state in each run is different, and that is the reason why you are getting this kind of measurement statistics. And only when you are averaging, you lose that information that is happening in a single measurement run, and you get the average statistics which we are. So. I'll just tell you the protocol quickly. So, what is influencing the outcome of my measurement is the system bath interaction. So, the system is interacting with the bath. And let's say if I do four measurements in this setting, that I create a motion that it evolves when I measure. Four measurements corresponds to 16 possible strings. Now if you ask, if I would have only taken this particular string, or this particular string, is there some knowledge that I'm gaining in addition to what I get from a standard average decoder string? So just like, if you compare with the pointers problem, so when the condenser completely decovers, so there's a 50-50 chance for it to be here. So it's like a classical mixture, so maybe you can think of a point. So if you're tossing the coin four times and these are independent events, so you say that there's an equal probability for all the 16 events. But if you say that the system is interacting with the bar and every measurement is in turn affecting the bar, like back action, then what you should see is a completely different statistics. That certain measurement results are more preferable than others. So this is like a theory prediction, and just you want to see if one can really see this kind of non-classical features in measurement statistics. Very quickly, I just give you a kind of theory for this. So what we're doing is like, again, you start with a B state, and then you're projecting A, and then you're asking what is the effect on B. So definitely it involves unitary evolution and a projective measurement, so this effective operation on B is a non-unitary operator. And yesterday we were also looking about some quantum state engineering, quantum operators and so on. So this state, the steady state that you get because of this measurement is nothing but the maximum eigenvalue state of this non-unitary operator. So and solving that is a hard problem, and so this could also assist you. So the reward, I say that what you get in terms of this learning is like you get to some new state of the environment which would help increase the coverage of the model. And measurement back action is not new, so this is also already known. It will work like, again, you're asking like there's some atoms going through, and then there is a time series of jumps that one sees of when the atoms are being measured here. Then you want to ask, does this make any sense? Is there a cavity state which uniquely represents this measurement data? So in a sense, like it's also like classification, you're asking in a 2N dimensional Hilbert space, can I assign a measurement string uniquely to each and every composition? If that is possible, then that is. Because in a sense, you can differentiate each and every composition. So experimentally, what we do is, I skip these details. So this is like the answer that I was showing, and these are some optical pulses who are doing this projective measurement readout. And once I do this measurement for a few times, then I do my FID experiment to learn if by doing this part, if I change the decoherence rate of the quantum system. So this is the experimental data. And what you see is like indeed, depending upon the time that you choose to do these measurements, you can get statistics which well mimic what is predicted. So you get So in a sense, like, depending upon the time you do the measurements, there are some measurements which are more preferable than the others. So in fact, if I average over all the 16 measurements, I get back the standard FID. And yeah, so these are like, one can also see zero and anti-zero effects depending upon what was your measurement. So this is one experiment where we like saw something, huge improvements in something. Like what we do is like we do a certain number of measurements, then we wait so that during these measurements, during this manipulation, if the environment has been really projected onto some nice way, and if the memory is good, then it can be alive for a while, and then it will reproduce the same statistics as before. It's because you have manipulated the environment and then you kept it constant. And what we see is remarkably that from something like 1.2 microsecond, you could almost go to a coherence of 1 second. So it's like 6 orders of improvement in decoherence time. So what we will do in visual decoherence control is you are using some spin echo techniques to control the environment. But here what you're asking is, are there some optimal environment states such that if environment is prepared into that state, it is least coupled to your quantum system. So and it exists, and actually it shows up experimentally. And so this is like this, how the actual path itself is changing. So it should be more like a parabolic black curve, but then depending upon your measurements, you are really changing the path quite much. So this is like you can have a programmable body of matter. And typically what prediction is that, in fact, if you ask for, in a general setting, a quantum system is interacting with the environment, and you don't, and you interact with completely arbitrary. And then you ask, is there, can one find the optimal quantum state of the environment that will not affect your quantum system? So we think that it's quite hard problem, but I did try to write a complexity class. But for some of our students setting here, we see that a kind of a spin liquid kind of a state is the optimal state, which helps the qubit survive its coherence for a much longer time than any other state. And we can also use this scheme to, that's what we're doing now, to control this cantilever, and take the cantilever to the ground state, basically the phonons to the ground state, and you can squeeze it, or you can also do lasing, which is. So maybe I'll talk about this. So, what are you doing? So, if you're interested in the end states, these end states are nothing but the maximum eigenvalue states of this non-unitary operator. And in general, diagonalizing non-unitary operators is quite a hard problem. So if you think in that way, like as the wave is trying to give you the minimum eigenvalue states of a Bayesian matrix, so our system could give you the maximum eigenvalue of some other hard problem. I don't know where non-unitary operators are having good place in classical analysis. But same as adiabaticity requirements for these things, what we have here is that the probabilistic outcomes of the measurements are the ones which are important. That it means that you have to do many measurements to get a particular sequence where like all of the measurements are zero or one. And this is also the classification problem. This was actually posed by Stanhall in 1972, but unfortunately it was not verified atom cavity experiments. What he asked is, can I tag every state in the universe space with a certain measurement output? And he says, you can do that. Because in every quantum jump experiment that you see, the atom guys, they show you a picture with a lot of jumps. And these are like, at least the lines that you see spikes are 1,000 or 2,000 or even more. So it's like you have the ability to do this 1,000 measurements, which means that the possible outcomes are 2 to 3,000. So is this amount of classical data enough to tag every state in the universe? Yeah, maybe we can get to some answer, at least for the case of few spin environments, if this could be done, then this would lead to some different kind of classification data. And just as error correction, as you're pointing out, if the abrupt changes, for example, something has happened to the path, and then what you see is like a sudden change in the statistics, the probability of finding a certain result. And in that sense, one can maybe once the talks in the morning, so with quantum change points, so this could also be like used to learn about the errors that are happening. This is what, so we We're planning to think of some kind of a simple intelligent quantum sensing device that one could make, because what we are doing is experimentally, like you're trying to sense a huge protein and there are different chemical species in the protein. And right now in the experiment, what we do is for every chemical species you have to use a different pulse sequence to detect the species. But if we bring in machine learning techniques, maybe the sensing could be done in a intelligent fashion that the device is trying to automatically adjust itself for a given chemical species and do the sensing in a much more faster, sort of gaining time or something. And just like I say, this is leading to quantum engineering. And here is also one aspect that one can use, because what you're doing is given measurement trajectory is preparing the environment in a certain state. And that could be a starting point for some other quantum computation. So this measurement trajectory could be like a key that Alice can pass off. And you can say that use this measurement string, and that would be the starting step for a computation. If he doesn't have that key, then any computation that he does makes no sense. So in that sense, because the these trajectories, measurement trajectories, can also be used in that fashion to really use the environment in a more useful way. There are also some concepts of quantum Darwinism. Maybe we can also test those things. And some error correction, and also we can also think about multiple quantum agents and how information about the environment is also somewhat hidden in the correlation that used in this multiple agents of some kind. I quickly thank people who are doing the experiments in the group, and also students helping me in theory, and he is the PI of the research group, and I thank you all for your attention.
We have time for one super quick question. It doesn't. John?
So you're considering that the environment is finite? Small?
No, because these experiments, which are done like, we don't match anything. So maybe they could be like 40.
So by measuring the signal state, you're comparing environment?
Yes.
What thermalized? So the environment has also is thermalized, which has a meta environment also.
Okay, so it has a thermal time which is quite long. So it's like it could be like for 10 seconds or something. The nucleus is quite stable. So in sense, whatever changes are there, can stay. This acts on like every measurement is in a sense, some sense, taking away the entropy from the past. Mm-hmm. So the more measurements you're able to make on this, you're more like purifying it, it's like an LOC.
More questions, and please, I'll just give you a break. Thank you.